So I'm going to be talking about tools for maintaining an open source project. So my name's Ben. I'm a software engineer for the BBC here in the UK. I work in a team called BBC News Labs. We create prototypes and kind of find new ways to deliver journalism and help journalists do their work in BBC News. I spent the last 6 years before this year working at the Raspberry Pi Foundation. So I've spoken at ATO before, representing Raspberry Pi. But I'm just going to be talking about kind of open source in general at the moment. So in this talk, so I've created a few kind of popular open source libraries and projects. So GPIO0 and PiWheels are two Raspberry Pi focused projects that I've worked on. I'm going to be mentioning those as some of the examples in the talk. I also write for opensource.com, which I think you'll have heard a lot about in the context of this conference, as they're quite involved in the conference, and I'll mention them again at the end. And you can find me on Twitter, I'm Ben_Nuttall, and that's a link to my GitHub. So I just wanted to point out the t-shirt I'm wearing. It's a kind of cool one I bought recently that fits in well with all that's going on. So stay at home, wear a mask. I thought that was quite cool. So yeah, that's all. So what this talk covers, so I'm going to be talking about how to organize your code base in different ways, sharing code and distributing your software, using Git and GitHub, testing and automated testing, documentation, writing and hosting documentation, and licensing your software. So those are the kind of the key strands of this, but I'll recover this at the end. So what this talk is not, this is not a thorough follow along tutorial of how to use each of the, you know, I don't know how many tools I mentioned in this talk, but there's quite a lot, and I'm not gonna be able to tutor you all the way through every single one. I would point you at other resources to go and learn about any individual that you want to learn more about, but I'm going to be mentioning a lot and just showing you little snippets of how I have found these tools useful. I'm also not kind of selling any of these tools or pitching them or telling the these are the right tools to use. These are just some that I've used in the past and found useful myself. So I'm sharing my own experiences. I'm also not telling you that you need to know all of these tools inside out in order to be considered a proper programmer. Absolutely not. I learned about a lot of these tools, you know, more recently than you would think, and I'm learning new stuff all the time. So I just like to share what I found useful with other people. And also, this is not a diss at the tools that I don't mention in this talk. For every tool that I mentioned, there's, you know, several alternatives. I'm not trying to direct you in one particular way. Just these are the ones that I've used and I wanted to talk about. Anything I don't mention is not in disrespect. So how to, as Brian said, how to engage with the talk. So feel free to add comments into the chat at any time. Actually, now this is the point where I realize I can't actually see the chat now. Let me see if I can get it up. If I can't get it up, then I will show you, then I'll have to refer to it at the end. I was hoping to be able to follow along. No, I've got it again. Great. Okay, so yeah, feel free to chat, post stuff in the chat. And if I spot a question while I'm giving the talk that I can kind of refer to, then I'll perhaps be able to address it. If it's something more detailed, it's going to send me off in a different direction, I'm going to have to avoid it and maybe come back to it at the end. So, you know, you can ask some questions at the end as well. And of course, you can always reach out to me on Twitter and ask questions or anything else later on. Okay, so. So just to cover a lot of the kind of experiences that I'm talking about, the stuff that I've learned over the last few years have been through these two projects that I mentioned. So GPIO0 is a Python library. It provides a simple API to physical computing that's doing stuff with electronics with a Raspberry Pi. It eases the learning curve for younger people and other beginners and educators. And it's a nice Pythonic API with advanced tooling to give experienced programmers something more interesting to do. So there's kind of lots to that, and a lot of the tools I'm using I kind of used for the first time in a project like this, so just to give you some reference. And PiWheels is the other one. So this the long story of this is that it's it automates building Raspberry Pi compatible Python packages so that Raspberry Pi users can get access to Python libraries much much quicker than they would otherwise. And we kind of automate the compilation process for that. So first of all, distributing software. So this can mean lots of different things. It can literally just be making access, giving access to giving people access to files that they need to be able to run your code. So sort of sharing the actual code that you're writing with other people, and that could be simple as hosting it on a personal website or on another site that people can download that code from and use it for themselves and maybe modify it for themselves. But in a more sophisticated way, when we talk about software distribution, we're talking about things like, well, am I able to apt install it or DNF install it or yum install it on a Linux using a Linux package manager, or language specific package managers such as pip, npm, so pip for Python, npm for JavaScript node, and gem for Ruby. And then there's things like the Linux portable distribution systems like Snap and Flatpak and AppImage. And then on Mac, there's things like Homebrew. And as I mentioned, just something being present online on a personal website or on GitHub or GitLab or SourceForge, being able to download it from the internet and get access to that software. That's a kind of method of distributing software, but in a sort of less sophisticated way. So why would we? Why do we distribute software in the ways that we do? So there's ease of access. So being able to access that software easily and know that, you know, you can just look it up. If you've heard of a project, look it up by name. You should be able to find a way to install it. The expectations that a user might have. So if you're making a Python library, there's an expectation in the Python community that that you should be able to pip install that library. And if it's something specific to a Linux distribution, you would expect that, you know, if it was a high enough standard, that it would be in the apt repositories or the repositories of your distribution. And being in, you know, specifically in Linux distribution repositories, that kind of gives you a sort of certificate of authenticity, almost, that it's that you can trust that has been had a lot of eyeballs on it and has been approved by the maintainers of that repository. So there's a certain amount of trust that what you're getting is legitimate, and it's not spyware, and it's not it's not going to corrupt your system, it's not a virus, that kind of thing. As opposed to just being able to download it from some dodgy looking website. And also stability. So if you have a system where you release your software to a repository, the idea that you're able to push out releases, security updates, new features, but also especially with things like the Linux distributions, that every time there's a new version of the Linux distribution, that there's a certain stability that you know that version will stick with that distribution and you won't be kind of getting the bleeding edge changes. So different levels of different ways of approaching things, but there's lots of different reasons why you want of things you want to consider when you're distributing software. So using a Git repository, this is a really good start. If you a lot of times you start code, you just start writing the code on your own computer, and then what you would do is you would create a repository on something like GitHub, and you would push it to GitHub, and then it's kind of shared with the world, and it's, even if nobody knows about it yet, it's just there. Another way you can do it is that you could create your repository on GitHub, clone the empty repository onto your machine, and then start working on your code straight away and pushing the changes back to GitHub. That also means that you can that other users can contribute either with you or unknowingly contribute to it aside from what you're doing, and push their changes to GitHub in a way that you could choose to accept the changes. So something like this, you would go to GitHub and create a repository, clone get the details you need to be able to clone that to your machine, and how you would push your changes back. And so it'd be something like this. You create a directory, initialize a new Git repository or clone it from GitHub, and connect your local version of your files and your code to the GitHub origin. And so, yeah, as I say, when we're talking about distributing software, if you've just written a handful of Python files and it's just a case of, well, if you've got these files on your computer and you run this file, then you've got the features that I've created. So in a way, all you need to be able to do is distribute those files and let other people have access to them. Or even, you know, obviously to be able to open them and modify them, change them for their own purposes, and potentially share the changes back. And so one easy way of doing that is to put it on GitHub, and it's just out there. It's a bit like a sharing a folder in layman's terms, in at the most basic level. And so with GitHub, the way it works is you can create a repository under your own name. So if you're this is my username, Ben Nuttall, and I've created some projects which kind of belong to me in that they're a personal repository belonging to my user. What you can also do is create organizations. So that doesn't have to be a company, it doesn't have to be anything in particular. Just you could just decide to. So in this case, the PyWheels project has a PyWheels repository, which is the main source code for the project itself, but it also has other projects that are related to this project. So what I did was to bundle them all together and provide them in one place, was to create the PyWheels organization and then publish different repositories within that. So it's quite common to see this thing where you've got the main project has the same name of the organization, and you'll see, so it'll be github.com/PyWheels/PyWheels. And then you've got lots of other repositories as well. But if it's just personal, that's fine. You can just publish it there. And you can also move them later. If you want to create an organization at a later date, you can move them and change them and things like that. So you can add collaborators to your project. So individual collaborators, or if you're part of an organization, you can add people to the organization so they have access to the repositories. And there's lots of different ways that you can manage that. So GitHub also gives you branches. So this is part of the Git protocol, that you have multiple branches. There'll be a kind of a main branch, and you've got lots of your sort of feature branches that people can be working on. The way that what that means is people can be working on different features at the same time, or you could even create different features and start from what was in the main branch to begin with, and you can merge the changes back in when each of them are ready. GitHub also allows you to publish your releases, so you can mark a particular commit. So once you've done a particular amount of work, you might say, well, this is constitutes sort of this version number, so this is version 1.0, 1.1, and you publish it at that point, and then that's one of the ways you can manage your releases. And you might, if you're tied in with other systems, you might be able to share those same releases with something like PyPy or pip, the Python package manager. And so GitHub also provides issues. So the first thing you think of when you talk about issues is other people, your users, filing bugs against your code. So that's one way that issues can be used, and obviously that's a good thing as well. But also that you can create your own issues on your own repository, not just bugs, not just things that don't work, but you know, things like I tend to use lists of features that I want to see in my project, and use or even just an issue per feature that I want to see, and then I'm able to do the work, push the changes up, and then close the issue to say that this feature that I wanted to see is now complete. So that could be a good way of managing your project as well. So you can see this is what a bunch of different GitHub issues looks like in your project. You can use labels to organize them and things like that. And every issue and every pull request, which we'll talk about next, is a conversation as well. So it's not just the code, it's not just the changes, it's the conversations you and your collaborators and your maintainers and your users are having around this issue. And they can be a really good way of driving the collaboration and making the decisions. So I would recommend looking at GitHub issue templates. So especially if you're expecting issues from your users, you need to know a certain amount of information to be able to deal with people's issues and requests. So you might be able to lay out a template to say, this is the information we need from you to be able to look into your problem or your suggestion. So you can define what that is and add that template. And then when somebody goes to create an issue, they're not just saying my thing doesn't work and hit send. They have to actually fill out, you know, a basic template to say, this is the version I'm using, this is the thing, and this is, you know, these are all the whatever it is that are related to your project. And so it looks something, you could have something like this. This is one of my issue templates. So pull requests are a way that GitHub uses to manage somebody who has created a branch, of your code, made some changes to it, and they're pushing them back to you and asking you if you want to merge their changes in. And so this can be a way for external users or for yourselves and your own maintainers to be able to manage changes so that you can have more eyes on things, so that people aren't just pushing stuff into your code. And so then you've got essentially a choice whether you want to accept this or not. And again, you can have a conversation around this and ask the person who opened the pull request to provide more detail or to make some changes or anything that you want to suggest, and you can have a conversation around that. So project boards are a really good way of managing issues and pull requests as well. So you can create a board, import all your issues and use this to organize them. So if you've got like lots of issues that you want to deal with, you can organize them in this way and be able to see what's going on in the project and where things are and what's blocking things. So licensing. So this is the kind of thing that a lot of people skip over, but it is really important. So just to highlight again, I'm not going to specify a particular license I think you should use, but I just want to stress that it is important to choose a license for your project, and it's important that you specify which license your project uses. The main point I want to make about this is that it's very easy to say, well, you know, I'm not really interested in the, you know, intricate details of which license we should use. You know, it's kind of a boring thing to worry about. It's just open source. People can do what they want with it. But if you actually look at the licenses and think, well, what would actually annoy you? If somebody, it's possible for somebody to do something with your code that you're not happy with. And so think about things that have happened to other people. So if you've got a project and it gets acquired by some big company, or not acquired, sorry, if it gets forked by some other company and they start producing things with it, and maybe they change the name of the project and sort of rebrand it and do all those things, a lot of the open source licenses would allow that. So if you'd be happy for that to happen, then, you know, choose an appropriate license. If not, then there are other options. That's just one kind of use case, but there's lots of things that you can that you need to consider before it's too late. So it's important to say that it's important to include the license with the source code and any distributions that you make. So if you make releases and your code is going to end up scattered across the globe running on other people's machines, you actually have to include the license with the code as it gets moved around. Otherwise, you've just got some code that is unlicensed as far as the user is concerned. But the best place to learn about licenses and which ones you should use is a website, chooselicense.com, which tells you all about, you know, the differences between, and gives you a kind of an easy way to navigate that. So this is a kind of a talk I've given previously, but in the context of Python. So a lot of the examples that I'm kind of using are Python related, and then but they're going to be, you know, sort of transferable. So if you start creating a Python package that you want to produce as an installable Python package, you generally start with a single Python file, and your code lives in that file. But what you want to do to be able to make it, you know, become a Python, an installable Python package, is just a little bit of organization. So you move your project code into a project folder within the repository, and you would create a setup.py. Now, obviously, there's lots of different ways of doing this for different languages, but just to give you an idea of the kinds of things that you need to to find out about. So I've got my, here you can see there's an init.py and the project code. There's a readme and a setup.py. So the setup.py would just contain, in the case of Python, this would just contain things like details about the name of the project, the version of the package that you're at, the author, some description, which license you use, and that kind of thing. But this is just the basics to get started. There's lots more that you need to look at. And basically, that's cut quite short. But the basis of that is what you need to be able to publish your Python module on the Python package repository. So depending on your language or the kind of thing you want to be doing, there'll be different kinds of steps. But that's just an overview of what you need to do to be able to publish a Python module. And there's lots of tutorials for reading about that. And the same similar sort of process would go down for NPM or GEMS or something like that. In Python, there's something called virtual environments. So this is a way for you to create an environment that's isolated from your system. So it doesn't have connection to all of your system packages and things. So it's kind of an isolated environment that replicates sort of if a new user had installed this, you're in an environment like how you can assume that they would be in. So you kind of build your project inside this environment and you do all your development with just this environment. So you're not accidentally having, had dependencies on things that only you have on your machine that other users of other operating systems might not have. And again, with other languages, there'll be different ways of dealing with this. So make files are not particularly they're very popular, but they're not talked about very much. And I've kind of been using them a lot more recently and find that they're a really good way of managing things like this in your project. So just having a simple make file. So this is an entire make file that has two commands. Providing this means that I can define what make install does. So the command make install will do pip install dot, and make develop will do pip install e minus e dot. And then you have these kind of lines that describe what those things do. So if somebody just types make in your project, it will echo out these two lines and tell them how to interact with your project. So they're a really good way of just providing. So if your installation changes at some point, you change it in here, but the command make install still takes effect. So it's a really good way of just providing simple documentation and commands for other people using your project. And I'll come back to this later when we start adding tests and things like that. But it's just for a really simple thing to begin with, having these universal commands that will just work for everybody. In a really simple way and not have to copy around several lines of code at a time to set up your environment. Things like that can be really useful. And as I say, as things change, this doesn't, the contents of this change, but the commands don't necessarily have to, and you can always add new commands. So testing. So the idea of software testing is to write tests to validate what your code is supposed to do. And it's not just a one-shot thing. So while I'm implementing a feature, I write tests for it and then I throw them away. You add to this kind of testing repository of all the tests, of all the things that all the bits of your program and your library or whatever are supposed to do. So you keep those tests around, and then it means that if you're working on a feature one day and somebody else in the future is working on a completely different feature, but they change a bit of code that makes your feature some edge case of your old feature stop working, they might have inadvertently introduced a bug that when they run the test that you wrote could be a long time ago, might all of a sudden start failing. And it means that they would realize that, oh, I've got to go and address these edge cases for this old feature that we have, because I don't want to start breaking old features. So in an ideal world, that you would never be able to release code that had bugs in it because you've tested all the old features. Now that's obviously impossible because you can't write perfect software, but having a thorough test suite can be really helpful in preventing bugs and things like that coming up. So another approach, I'm not going to sort of bang the drum too loudly, but for maximum effect, write your tests before you write the code. So it's very easy to just sort of type away and build, you know, write your new feature and then add some tests. But a lot of people like to use this test-driven approach where they write the tests first, see them fail, and then they write the code that makes them pass and have this kind of cycle that they work through. And that can be a really effective way. But it's not always the way people work, so that's fine. So testing locally is really important. So actually running the tests on your machine and verifying before you've even pushed the code or shared the code or opened a pull request or certainly done any releases, that you've actually verified for yourself that the tests are passing. So any new tests that you've written for your new feature and that you haven't broken anything that somebody wrote in the past. And again, it can be really easy to get started with this, as I'll show in the next few slides, but then you can move to automating your tests. So when you push to GitHub, they get run automatically by some service, which can be really useful as well, especially when you get pull requests from other people. If the tests are automatically run, you know, that's really helpful. So be pragmatic. So don't test every single possibility of everything that could ever happen, every type of input that can go through your system. If you wrote a function that you know, multiplied numbers, you wouldn't be expected to write tests for every single combination of all the numbers. Otherwise, there wouldn't be any point to writing software to automate that. So find the edge cases. Where is it likely to break? What's slightly different use cases, and test those especially. So really, it's really important to be pragmatic there. So basic testing in Python, there's a built-in assert keyword in Python that allows you to run basic assertions to say this should equal this and don't continue if it does. So you can just have another test file away from your project and that just lists all of these assertions that, like I said, test this particular case. And that's a really easy way to get started. You don't have to learn testing frameworks and things. You can get away with quite simple tests to begin with. There's a library called PyTest that helps you kind of wrap around your tests and give you some nice output. So the only difference between basic testing using assert and using PyTest is to wrap them in these functions called test underscore, and then put your assertions in there, and then they're broken down. You get some really nice output. And the way you generally, certainly in Python, but this is quite common in most languages, is you would have your project source in here, in this directory, and you would have a test directory sort of adjacent to that along within your repo, so that other people can see the tests as well. And so, you know, when you know, with that example I just gave, it's just a simple test. This is PyTest running it, so you can see there that it's run this test and it's passed, and that's the output that you get. And if you get any failures, you'll see stuff in red and it will tell you which ones failed and why they failed. You can also do more advanced things like raising assertions and check that assertions have been raised under certain circumstances. Lots of more detail that you can go into with that. The talks is again a Python specific thing, but this will enable you to run your tests on multiple Python versions. And again, there'll be other things for different languages. In Python, there's something called coverage.py, but the idea of test coverage analysis is common amongst all languages. So the idea of running your tests and then seeing, well, which lines, how much of my code was actually tested when it ran through, and it will log, well, this line actually never got hit by any of the tests. This part here is not currently tested, and you can get a percentage, and you see a breakdown of which parts of your code are not being touched by the tests, which helps the effect, you realize the effectiveness of your tests. So you might get something like this showing you which lines. So there's, generally speaking, in this case, there's lots of test coverage, but you can see, well, this bit needs quite a lot of attention, or this bit does, and actually focus your efforts on there. So pushing pushing your tests and have the tests run automatically. There's a project called Travis, which is really good. I've used this for a few years. More recently, I've moved over to using GitHub Actions because it's nice and integrated with GitHub. So you can go to GitHub Actions and it will suggest things based on the programming language you're using. But what I've generally done is started with this workflow, the Python package workflow, and sort of just modified it to actually just run make test, because my test, my make file has the testing commands in there. And that's all I need to do, really. So instead of using specific pip commands or whatever, I'm just saying, well, whatever's in my make test command. And when you get a when you've got an action set up that runs all these checks, now it can run linting, it can run your test suite, it can run coverage analysis, it can do all sorts of things like that, whatever you you choose. Whenever you get a pull request, it will run all the checks, or wherever you push, it will run all the checks and show you, you know, you want to see these all green ticks for all the different environments you want to run in. And if somebody's written some code which will break your tests, then you see that in the pull request straight away, which is really, really important. And so, like I said, you know, my next thing to add to the make file here would be the make test. And then I've just described what the commands are that I need to be able to run my tests. In this case, it's some couple of commands to do with the coverage analysis and running PyTest and where they are and all that kind of thing. I don't want to have to remember this command and type it every single time, just make test every single time, even if that changes, that can be really useful. So onto documentation. So there's a really good blog post that you can read on this URL, documentation.divio.com. A friend of mine sort of does this really good conference talk on documentation. So I wanted to start with that. So the idea is that there are four types of documentation and people generally mix them up. So there's things like tutorials, which are learning oriented, and they're about taking you through step by step and you typing commands when you're told to and following along and that kind of thing. And there's kind of how-to guides, which are problem oriented. So there's things like how do I get X to do Y? And it's not going to start from the beginning. It's going to assume that you've got a certain amount of knowledge and you've used these things before, and it will teach you how to solve a particular problem. So there's, you know, nailed into a specific type of context. And then you've got explanation. So it might be blog posts and kind of, you know, explaining why things are the way they are, how you generally take different approaches. And then there's things like reference. So your API documentation that says, well, this class has this method and this method and this method, and these are the parameters that they take, and these are the types that they take. And they're kind of four completely different types of thing. They're all useful, and you can have them all within the same place, but not necessarily in the same body of text. So if you've got a page that says this is the documentation for this, it should just be one of these four things. And so I'll just run through a few ways of sharing your documentation. So GitHub provides a really simple way in that it renders any markdown. So a markdown file looks something like this. You just write this syntax. This means header one, this means header two. Some text goes here, and these are some bulleted list items with a link to a website. And you can publish it as part of your repository, and it will just render in HTML. So it's a really nice way of just providing simple instructions and documentation that way. And there's also a project called MKDocs, which is markdown-based documentation builder. And it exports you a whole website of static HTML that you can then deploy. So you just write some markdown, tell it to bundle that into HTML and then deploy it. And you can host that anywhere. So you can host it on GitHub pages, or you can self-host it. It's a really good starter. I've used that for some small projects. But for bigger projects, especially things like Python libraries, I've tended to use restructured text, which is a bit more sort of verbose and has a bit more of a learning curve to it. But similar sort of thing. You've got this kind of different approach to headers, but essentially lists and links and references are kind of similar, but it's a lot more powerful because you can tie in with other, you can link to different pages within the site in a quite neat way. And you can also have it extract the documentation from your doc strings. So if you've written, and this will be for multiple languages, but In Python, if you write a doc string for a class or for a method or for a function, it will extract that and generate you a web page with all of your API documentation. And you can kind of mix stuff together. So you could write paragraphs of text and then say, well, actually, I've got an intro here, and then I want to have the class documentation for this class. And these are the things that I want you to show. So show these methods and these properties. And the ones that I've omitted, I don't want to show. And you have a lot of control, and it's a really good way of writing good, thorough documentation. So you might have seen this on things like the Python documentation. The Python language documentation itself is written in restructured text and is deployed using this project called Sphinx. And then there's something called Read the Docs, which is a way of hosting your docs as well. So using Sphinx, that allows you to it sort of automatically tags the versions according to when your releases were, and then you have access to your documentation at particular version points. So I want the version 1.0 docs, or the 1.1 docs, or the 1.2, or just the latest. And if you have branches and you've got something in progress, you can check it out and see it live as well. And you know, you can automate this, so when you do a release to GitHub and it's tagged as this is a new version release, it will go and build the new version of your docs and publish that as a new branch as well. And finally, there's a project called GraphViz, which allows you to generate graphs and diagrams from that might supplement your documentation, which I use quite a lot. So it's a little obtuse, one of those things you've got to learn, but basically this is describing how this diagram looks. It's just essentially the word button pointing to the word LED, but describing using these types of graph elements and things like that, and can be really useful. I've used it for automatically generating things like class diagrams and stuff like that within the GPIO0 library, which is really useful. And you can have the source code of what you can see here within your repository, so that it's just part of alongside your code. So I'm just wrapping up now. So just to go over what the talk covered. So we talked about organizing your code base, so the module structure, things like the Python, things like setup.py and your make files, sharing code and distributing software. So using things like pushing to GitHub and publishing on PyPI, and so people can install with pip. Using Git and GitHub, repositories, users, organization, collaborators, issues, pull requests, project boards, and so on. Automated testing, documentation, and licensing software. So I write about the tools that I come across on a blog called tooling.bennuttall.com. So I kind of, it was supposed to be weekly, but it's drifted a little. And I also write for opensource.com, and there's people within the conference you can talk to about writing for them if you want to contribute as well. But do check that out. And that's all from me.